Christmas won't be Christmas without any presents. It's so dreadful to be poor. I've worked over this old dress 1,000 times, but it has to be ready for Sally Gardner's New Year's party. Sally has such nice new clothes. I don't think it's fair for some girls to have plenty of pretty things, and other girls to have nothing at all. We have more than nothing at all, Amy. Think of the Hummel family, living in a one-room cabin. They have nothing at all.
We've got father, mother, and each other.
I meant nothing new. For Christmas, besides, you haven't got father either. He's off to the war. What an adventure it'd be to be a soldier. Women should be able to be soldiers, too. No, you're only 15. You're not old enough. I could lie about my age. I could wear a big mustache and beard and call myself in the North, age 23, late of Tortuga. My cutlass has been action across the Spanish main, and hearing of the minor skirmish has decided to lend its power to that of the righteous union. Joe, our father is a chaplain in the army. I'm sure he would see much action. I don't think you'd like to be in a real battle anyway. I'm glad the fighting is far away, but father was needed there. He provides comfort and solace to the other soldiers.
Solace, Amy. He provides solace to the other soldiers.
I don't know why you won't correct me when I try out his words. It's quite proper for a young lady to try new words and improve her boaster ability.
There is no such word as boaster ability.
Let you know, my teacher says a large boaster ability is the hallmark of a gentle and refined lady.
Vocabulary, Amy. Well, anyway, the reason mother proposed us to not having any presents this Christmas is because she thinks we ought not to spend money on frivolous things, since money is scarce. Still, I wish I could get a new dress. I would like a new book. Jiminy Crickets, I read every book we own twice.
Josephine March, don't sing Jiminy Crickets like that. It's not ladylike. Drawing pencils. That's what I need.
Amy, our resident artist. You do draw very well.
Beth, what would you want?
I wish Father were back home. That'd be Christmas present good enough for me.
Beth, we are right, of course.
Well, we each have some money, don't we? Mother didn't say anything about our own money. We can treat ourselves for Christmas. Ben, don't you have some money?
Well, yes, a little.
And doesn't Aunt March pay you to be her companion, Joe?
Yes, she opens up that big fat pocketbook every once in a while to give me something.
And Beth, don't you have money for some sheet music?
Not anymore.
Not anymore? Did you lose it? Was it stolen or something?
I spent it. I know we weren't supposed to, but mommy's slippers are so worn. I bought a new pen. I don't have any money left.
That sounds so thoughtful.
I got a new pen too. You did. She needed new gloves. I hid a new pair under the tree over there.
Oh, my sisters, it can now be revealed that I have written my newest play, chillingly entitled The Witch's Curse, as a homemade gift for Marvin.
The Witch's Curse? I haven't heard that one before.
Of course not. I just finished it. And here are your parts. Beth, you will play Haggard, the Gruesome Witch. Who kidnaps you? I mean, Princess Nomniquin in her dreaded cavern. I will have to play two parts. Beth, you will play Hugo, Haggard's henchman.
Do I have to be in your play, Joe? I'm getting too old for such things.
Nonsense. You enjoy dressing up just like the rest of us.
I don't know how you'll cope up with some stars like this, Joe. Regular Shakespeare.
Rodrigo, save me!
No. Do it this way. Clasp your hand over your heart and cry out, Rodrigo, save me! And then faint onto the good wall.
Glad to find you so merry, my girl.
My honey!
Oh, my sweet girls.
He says that he is well, and that he is so sorry to have to lose all love.
all sorts of loving wishes for Christmas and a special message to the girls. Give all of them, my dear, love and a kiss. Tell them I think of them by day, pray for them by night, and find my best comfort in their affection at all times. I know that when I come back home, I will be fonder and prouder than ever of my little women.
Is everyone ready for Christmas dinner?
Can I smell it?
Those are popovers. We haven't had popovers in ages.
Here, let me help you with that. Oh, I remember we used to have feasts like this all the time, not just on special occasions.
Too true. I had the same food stores over the last week to make all of this.
Oh, look, oranges. Just think, oranges in the wintertime. Beth, can you smell them?
It smells like summer.
I'm going to eat the sausages all by myself. Just try.
Why don't you girls go grab a plate from the kitchen?
Oh, Hannah, it looks like you've really outdone yourself.
What a special treat for everyone.
I'm glad to do it, Miss March. I love to cook, and it's so rare to get such an opportunity for it. Things are as they are.
Yes, the war has made some food scarce.
And more expensive. Still feeding the whole family. No money, no food. I don't even think they have firewood to eat the place.
No heat? They're very poor. The father worked very hard for them, but when the conscription order came in, he just had to leave for the war, or else he would have been arrested.
But the Hummels are our neighbors. We should help our neighbors.
That's right. Couldn't we give them our extra firewood or something?
And we don't need all this food. We can share it with them.
What?
I think that's a great idea.
What?
Here, Beth, you take the plates and I'll take the cook.
I'll go get the extra firewood.
We have a pitcher of milk in the kitchen, don't we? The children should have milk.
To stay with me.
Merry Christmas, ma'am.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, ma'am.
Merry Christmas.
And this is his tutor, Mr. John Brooke.
Merry Christmas.
Happy Christmas.
Happy.
Mr. Brooke is English. That's how they say it.
Oh, well, happy Christmas to you.
I was just making the introductions when the fire brigade came through.
Oh, grandfather.
This is Mr. John Brooke and my grandson. Theodore.
That's Faye, and that's Beth.
And I'm Joe.
Please call me Lori. I detest Theodore.
Lori? Isn't that a girl's name? You must excuse my young daughter, Amy. Well, it is too a girl's name. One of the girls in my school is named Lori.
All his friends in Europe called him that. I suppose he's gotten used to it.
Europe? You've been to Europe?
Well, yes, I was actually born there.
My aunt has always promised me that she would take me to Europe someday.
I hope to return someday.
Where did you live? Italy? Paris? London?
Mostly in Paris.
Paris? How wonderful it must be.
It's a beautiful city.
I always imagine Paris like a grand oil painting with artists dotting the horizon, painting the beautiful colors.
My mother was an artist.
Where are your parents?
The They both died.
I'm sorry.
It's not your fault. They both caught an illness. Not long after they died.
You know, Mother, I think the whole baby's now a leader. She looks so sickly.
You've gone down to see the Hummel family, have you?
Yes, that's where we were just now.
We gave them all our Christmas dinner.
Amy!
Well, it was very generous and hospitable. Hospitable, we
gave them your Christmas dinner?
Yes.
Well, yes, they needed it so badly.
Amy, that was very generous of you.
Then you have nothing for Christmas dinner yourselves?
I'll make some cold sandwiches for them.
I will not get it! You will all come and have Christmas dinner with us. We have a large Christmas goose, and we will be happy to share it with you.
Sounds like a splendid idea.
Oh, but how could we ever repay you?
Repay? What's this about repay?
We could repay them with my new play.
What's that?
After dinner, my sisters and I will perform the witch's curse for you.
The witch's curse?
I think singing Christmas carols might be more appropriate.
Do you play piano?
Yes, a little, but that is wonderful. That is quite the virtue of them.
Well, we have quite the big gap at home, and it hasn't been used in a very long time. Could you come and play some Christmas carols for us, and we will all sing them together?
Please, please, I have some sheet music, and I just had to play it. I just haven't practiced in a while.
We had to sell our piano.
Amy both did, and you had to have a nice dress to go to school in, young lady.
But then, after dinner, would you please perform the witch's curse for me?
I insist upon it. This is shaping up to be a grand evening.
There's a part for you in it, if you'd like. You can play Rodrigo, who rescues the princess.
And what part do you play?
I play Gonzalo, who captures the princess from the witch.
I must see this play. It sounds wonderfully exciting. Will you accept my invitation to a sharing meal in exchange for these delightful entertainments?
How could I refuse?
Come on, everyone. Off to dinner.
Lovely having him all over. Nice singing, Beth on piano. Beautiful. You wouldn't know that it's normally dull as a tumor right there, huh? But tell me, what are you going to do?
Promise you won't tell.
Cross my heart.
Okay. I can't let anybody see the back of my dress. So, I either have to stand against the wall the whole time, or sit down. And I so love to dance.
Dancing. Now I can reveal my wish to remain concealed. That's Sally Gardner. Her mother always wants me to dance with her daughter. There she is over there, hunting me like prey. I'm safe.
Don't you like to dance?
Well, I should think I would. I've done it at 100 parties, but Sally Gardner seems much more like an enemy scene.
The single girl first came up with that.
Something like that.
As a writer, I've used that plot device, but I can't say it ever.
You're not really a fan of writing.
I am. I'm very serious about it. My dream is to make all things awful. What do you want to do as a slave?
You mean when I grow up?
I suppose.
Yeah. It's all right. I don't quite consider myself grown yet. Grandfather has me set off to go to Harvard this fall.
So you're going to college?
Yes. I'm going off to study business, and that's why Mr. John Brooks is here. Any idea what it costs to go to Harvard?
No.
$150 a year.
You're kidding. whole country benefits from an educated population. Maybe. I don't know. What? You don't think I can go to college?
I never said you couldn't. It just seems like a bit of a radical idea.
There are a lot of women colleges. Someday there'll be more. I probably leave the education to women. That's why all my history friends are here. We're all homeschooled by Marnie, but it's kind of easy. She has a small upbringing right now, but she wanted to go to college, like Harvard, Yale. You should be allowed to go, alongside all of you rich men. What do you think of that?
I think you'd make a mighty fine lawyer. You argue your point with such passion. So, you really like to dance.
I do, but I don't get much of a chance to.
And you can't tonight because of your rather unfortunate.
Burn mark. Pass word over a burn mark.
I see. I have a solution for you.
You do?
Miss Josephine March, may I please have this next dance?
Here, in the alcove?
Well, yes. I'll be facing you. There will be none here to see your problems except for the wall. I'm sure we could take you home if you'd like.
Could you? I can't put any weight on this foot.
Of course. I'll go talk to the stable. John, you'll open the door?
Yes, yes, of course.
Come on, sisters, we have to get our meeting. Amy, Mad. Now that you've arrived, we start our meeting, the 52nd meeting of the Pickwick Society will come to order. If we must,
Mrs. Snodgrass,
I do indeed, and yet I will yield my time to Mr. Pickwick to be of any use to a part on our Pickwick Society. Yes, well, now the spring is upon us, and put on the glasses and all of the character. Well, now that spring is upon us and the planting season is here, I hope that all members of the Pickwick Society can reclaim their duties and help out with the garden. That's old business.
Dreary old business.
Well, how about you, Mr. Tupman? Do you have any news to report?
Mr. Winkle. Maybe he has some news.
Mr. Winkle, do you have any new news from over there under the lawn?
Well, the sun is very shiny today, and it's warm, and there's no school, so it's extra pleasant and
that's not news. That's the weather report. Well, I have some news to report. Gentlemen, do I have permission to report it?
Yes, pray enlighten us. What is this new business?
I propose the admission of a brand new member.
New member? Who?
I propose that Mr. Theodore Lorre, sometimes known by the simple epithet of Lorre, become an honorary member of our Penguin Club.
Lorre?
But he's a boy!
I want to join our Pickwick Society, Joe.
He does. We can't have a boy in the club, Joe. Family joke and bounce out. This is a ladies' gentlemen club, and we wish to remain private and proper.
He left us on your backs. She has solemnly promised me she will not.
I submit you to a vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Fair. Deadlock, 2-2. As president, I dare.
Will the deciding votes please step forward?
Has he been listening all along?
It's been awfully hard to talk to you, Mr. President. Esteemed gentlemen, pray allow me to become a humble servant of this immortal Pickwick Club.
So
progress here is not to be responsible for tonight's base strategium. It was my idea, and she only gave in after lots of teasing.
You liar! You know I told you to hide over there.
Oh, hush up. Never mind what she says. I'm the wretch that did it, sir, but on my honor, I shall never do so again, as long as you allow me to become a noble servant of your club.
Here, here, the pig with the side forever. Now, please say you used to be a member.
I'm all for it.
Well, since he has heard the secrets of the club before he was invited, he'll have to tell a secret before he joined. Oh, yes, he must tell a secret. That's it.
A secret, eh?
Lori, you don't have
to. Well, I actually do have one. A rather funny one. One that I think you should hear.
Me?
Yes, but if I am to tell it, I must first have your promises that I am to be a member of this club.
Let's take the vote again, shall we? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed.
All right.
Aye. Now what's this secret?
Is Mr. Pickwick perhaps missing a glove?
Yes, I was placed 1 month ago. I can't remember when.
I know, my dear. You lost it at Sally Gardner's New Year's Eve party.
I did?
Mm-hmm. And I know just where it is. That's my secret.
Where?
Mr. John Brooke has it.
Your tutor? Why ever doesn't he return it?
He likes to keep it in his pocket. He pulls it out and stares at it. He sniffs it.
Well, it's not peculiar.
I think it's lovely.
Now, I'm sure if he knew that you wanted it back.
And if someone knew where it was.
You could call upon him sometime to return it. How does that sound?
I should be very grateful for having found him.
Excellent. And what date works best for you, Mr. Pickwick?
This Sunday would be nice. Sunday afternoon. I'll be free at home all afternoon.
I'll let him know when I see him next. I'm sure that'll work just fine for him. Now, gentlemen, what news do we have to impart upon this august society?
I want the new member to tell a story. A new story.
Oh, a new story. Well, how ever will I come up with one of those on the spot?
Oh my.
It was a dark and stormy night. The rain fell in torrents. Except at occasional intervals when it was checked by a violent gust of wind. It swept through the streets. For it is in London that I've seen lie, rattling along the house tops, fiercely agitating the scanty flame of the light that struggled against the dark. You know, I always wanted to study music in college. My grandfather won't hear it.
Where's the money in that blamed music, Theodore?
Oh, he calls me Theodore. I despise that name.
Where's the money?
So, of course, I would be going off to learn about business. Numbers on a ledger, receipts, all that nonsense. It's all dull. All of it's dull.
If I had a chance to go to college, I think I'd want to study literature, poetry. I wouldn't want to study writing. I already know how to write. I don't need some stable professor telling me I write wrong.
A good stable living, Theodore, a good sound industry.
Oh, he's a right tyrant.
I think he's a dear, though he does bark somewhat.
Barks, yes. Bites, too. Trust me.
Amy, what's the matter?
Nothing.
Something. And something's wrong, I think.
It's...
Lori, you look at my mother in the other room. Amy, what's wrong? Here, let me take your books.
No.
I'm all right. Amy.
What's going on?
She won't tell me.
Let me see, Amy.
You can tell me what's wrong.
How did this happen?
He did it.
Why would you do that?
I was distracted because I had lines in my drawer.
Lines?
The girls give each other lines for this and that. It's silly, but it certainly isn't harmful.
He said, it's as difficult to educate a girl as it would be a female cat. Oh, he did he? Well, that tears it. You are not going back to that school. I will write a letter and withdraw you. You'll be homeschooled like the rest of the girls. Joe cannot be in charge of education from now on.
I'm sorry, Pooh.
The idea of striking a child.
Oh,
that brings out my temper. Here, let me see your hand again.
Oh, here, I'll take your place.
Joe, you go ask Meg for my med kit. She should know where it is.
Amy, did you draw this?
Oh, yes.
How did you get such a beautiful image out of this?
Oh, Ari is quite the artist.
And I'll wager that your teacher is exactly fond of your artistic talents.
He'd rather I drew stones.
Yes, I know the title.
But I think talent like hers should be fostered, not stifled. Math and bookkeeping are necessary for modern life, but a person who has this much talent should not be punished for expressing it.
Would you like to have a chat with my grandfather?
Here's the medicine kit, Marty.
Yes, thank you, girls. Here, there it is. The idea of striking a child. I'll write him quite the letter, I tell you. There. How does that feel?
Oh,
you
said it all.
Marty, I wrote to the boy from Western Union.
He gave me this for you.
A telegram?
It's from Washington.
What does it say, Marty?
Is it about Colin?
It's from a hospital in Washington, D.C. Your father has been wounded. He's alive, but his injuries are dying.
Oh, they're short of nurses. I'll have to go there. I have to take a train.
How will we afford that?
What can we do to help, Marty?
Meg, you'll have to look after the house and the girl for our car. Meg, you'll help me pack.
Me too.
Yes,
I will.
Well, Marty, I'm sure my grandfather would be more than willing to help.
Oh, Marty, I couldn't ask him for something like that, but I could ask you for something. Will you look in on my little women from time to time to make sure they're doing well?
Then I have the most agreeable assignment of all.
Marmy, where's your shawl?
It's in the leaf.
Don't you finish your wear?
No, I'm not taking anything outside of Washington.
You need this bag of sandwiches to
go. Okay.
Oh, yes. Can I
have your bonnet?
And an umbrella against the weather.
Put that next to the leaf. Here, you call me for the bonnet. Hannah, I'll take this from you in just a second.
Now, Meg, while I'm away, I'm going to need you to look after the girls. I don't know how long I'll be gone. And make sure Amy keeps after her studies.
And as for Joe, where's Joe?
You sent her off to Aunt March's.
Yes, I know, but that must have been hours ago. She should have gotten an answer by now.
Did you get that?
Of course.
Hello?
Oh, hi, Aunt March.
So, that lame fool of an old man has gotten himself injured involving himself in that silly little war of his.
Hello, Aunt March.
Thank you for coming, Aunt March. I told my nephew over and over that the war was none of his business and that he shouldn't get mixed up in it. Hello, girls. Amy, you look so pretty.
But where's Joe?
Joe's me. I haven't seen eye nor hair of her for weeks. Ah, money. It always comes to money. Just because I can keep mine and that nephew insists upon losing all of his at any opportunity. Well, I thought you would need some money. So, I brought you some. Here, take it. And you better use my carriage outside to take me to the train station. sure the driver returns my carrot straight away. I will wait here with the girls for a bit. And I'll take some tea, thank you.
I'll get tea.
Joe, where have you been?
I was just in the town. Here, Marty, here's the money for your trip. $25.
$25?
Wherever did you get it? I couldn't bear back Aunt March for the money, so I sold it to the line instead.
What did you know?
I'll be back in a few days. Come now, Miss Marsh. You don't want to be late for the train.
Yes, of course. My bags are right there. Goodbye,
girl. Bye. Ben, you'll look in on the Hummels from time to time, won't you?
Yes, Marsh. Oh,
goodbye, Mr. Jacob. I will give your father a hug and a kiss for you.
Safe travels.
Thanks, Mom.
Thanks.
Good night, Laura.
Good night.
Good night, the Pickwick Society for Laura Clinton.
Around.
Oh my goodness.
Yes, bring it right over here. Right over there. Yes, right inside.
On earth.
This thing is just wasting away in my house. Nobody plays it, nobody uses it. Not since I lost my own little girl. That was many, many years ago. You wouldn't have known her, of course, Theodore. That was long before you were born, but she was a sweet little girl. And she could make such sounds that the big house itself would ring. And I just thought, well, your girl likes the piano. At Christmas, she played it so beautifully, and I just thought,
that's very sweet of you, Mr. Watts.
I don't know if it's a tune, but why don't you show me, child?
Brooke. He's originally from London,
I see you join the army, John.
Yes, sir.
I can tell. That's in a good many fine boys, in your old verse of this couple. Don't you be one of them, son.
I won't sell. I promise.
Oh, my dear family, it is so very good to be home.
Did you like anything, Papa?
Everything I could ever want, right here in this room. Rest of my family, and safety, and peace.
So you won't be going back to Papa?
No, Joe. The war is over for me. I only pray for the day that it's over for everybody else.
Doctors poured through, and soon there were twin babies in their household. Aunt March finally took that promised trip to Europe, only she brought Amy along as her companion instead of me. Things were quite peaceful for us, until that afternoon when Laura returned from Harvard.
No, I thought you before you lay a nail in the concrete mural for me. But you said you knew if I actually graduated.
Did I? I must have forgotten.
You know, most people at the ceremony, I was most glad you were there.
What I was there for, moral support. Now that you've graduated, you should take a nice long holiday.
Yes, I intend to.
Europe, please.
Europe would be nice, wouldn't it?
Lauren, please don't.
I noticed you didn't take my arm at the luncheon either. You used to always take my arm as you walk.
Things are different now that we're older.
Yes, now that we're older. Joe, now that we're older, I've graduated. I'll be working full-time in my grandfather's company.
Lori, please don't.
Joe, this has to be said. The good of both of us, please, just sit down and listen.
Say what you need. I'll listen.
Joe, I've loved you ever since I've known you.
The fuck?
Couldn't help it. You've been so busy. Lord knows I've tried to show it. But now I need you to finally listen to me and finally give me an answer. That's the funny thing about girls. They say yes when they mean no when they mean yes, and they drive a man out of his wits just for fun.
No, girls no. Don't do that, and I don't either. I always say exactly what I think, and I never wanted to make you feel that way. I guess I've actually tried to distance myself from you, but then I value your attention too much.
Exactly. And I was hoping that tension would grow. Joe, I know I'm not half the man good enough for you.
Yes.
Please, don't tell me you love another man.
Nothing like that. What I wanted to tell you is, I don't think I'll ever love anybody in that way.
Yes, you will. And then what will become of me, Joe?
You'll find somebody else and forget all about this.
I can't just move on from this, Joe. I can't forget about you. I never can, and I never will.
You haven't heard what I wanted to tell you. Sit down with me. I want you to be happy, Lord. Really, you do. But you and I are too similar. We're rash, we're crazy. And all we do is argue, and then we regret it. We'd be miserable if we ever even thought about it.
Mary, Joe, that's the word, right? You're a master of the correct word, except for that one word that you fear oh so much. We wouldn't be miserable if we were married, Joe. Not if we were sharing life's happiness and joys.
Take a sensible view of it.
I won't be what you call reasonable. I won't take a sensible view. Oh, I don't believe you've got me hard.
I really wish I didn't have one. This would be a lot easier.
You know, you are disappointing everyone, not just me.
Everyone in our families expects us to marry Joe. Joe, please say you will marry me.
Can't marry you, Marty. You'll see that I'm right where Dave will thank you for it.
Oh, I'll be hanged if I do.
Yes, you will. You'll find some nice, lovely girl to get married to in your nice, lovely house. I couldn't be that for you, Lori. I'm weird and awkward. And you'd be ashamed to be seen with me, and then we'd argue about it, and we'd be miserable. I don't think I'll ever marry anybody, Lori.
Yes, you will, Joe. I know you better than that. There will come a time where you will find men who you will love and cherish with all of your heart, and I will be forced to stand by and watch as the woman I love is taken away from me, and I don't know if I can handle that, Joe.
For as well as you claim to know me, you don't know me that well. When I say I'll never marry anybody, I mean it. I love you, Lori, and I'm proud of you, but I can't marry you.
You'll be sorry one day, Joe.
Where are you going?
I'm off to the devil.
What the f- is wrong with these kids?
He looks so impossible.
What's the matter?
I can't tell you.
Can it be as bad as all that?
Honey, why do people have to grow up? Why can't they just stay the same and be happy forever?
Why don't you tell your mother what's troubling you? Oh, I see. His affections have grown in.
Mine haven't. I'm proud of him, Marty. And I love him, but for anything more than we have now, it's out of the question.
He's a good and kind man, but I guess he's just not the one for you. Jim, I have an idea.
What's that?
I have a friend in New York City. She has asked me if one of my daughters would like to be a governess to her children.
New York, that's quite a distance.
It would be an escape from all this. A new change.
It'd be good to get away for a while. A lot of writers in New York. There are a lot of publications there, too.
And if it doesn't work out,
I'll come right back home to you and Father.
And you're right.
I intend to. I intend to.
I mean, to us, Joe. For we are your family, and this is your home, wherever you may be.
Where I'm going right here every day. I started taking German lessons from the professor on all things. He always says, yeah.
Tonight, we will try to eat some shadows.
Have you been playing with the children again?
How on earth did you know?
Isn't a gentleman supposed to take off his hat in the presence of a lady?
What? Oh, Timmy, he must have put that on my head without me noticing. I must have been wearing it for hours. I wonder where he got this newspaper. The Weekly Volcano. What is this periodical?
That's the magazine I've sold some of my stories to.
You write for a volcano? I see. So, you don't mind if I read it?
It's not my best work. You see, the editor likes sensational tales. He says that stories more on sentiment don't sell, so I let my imagination run wild.
So I see. Your heroine is quite the adventuress. You say she needs a lunatic. Is that right? Well, your English is better than mine. Yes, I see this man is quite a lunatic. Joe, why don't you tell me something about your friends, your family?
Now, while you're reading.
I can do both. Just tell me anything.
Well, he told you about the word.
Frequently.
Well, he wrote me to ask him to marry him again. And I told him no. So he went off to Europe with his grandfather. It seems he's trying to write an opera, but he needs a heroine.
So, an opera?
Yes, but he's failing miserably at it. Seems he needs to know more about music than he does to write an opera. But he did run into my sister while in Paris.
Which sister was that?
Amy. She's younger, though. She's quite a young lady now. She's been on the continent with Aunt March for well over a year now.
Describe Amy.
She's the artist. She can draw such beautiful things. She's a little vain. She walked around for a whole month with a clothes put on her nose trying to improve in shape. She's a temper, though not as mine. There was one time she was so mad at us, we'd left her at home while we'd gone to see a play. And she decided that the best way to let out that anger was to throw my manuscript into a fire. All my writings, gone. Years of work. I thought I'd never forgive her.
But you did.
Of course. She's my sister. How could I not? And I realized later that I kept a copy of all my stories.
A copy? Where did you keep it?
In my head. I realized that later. Did you know that when I wrote down the stories for the second time, they were even better than the first?
Memory is often better than me.
Amy is the sweetest person in the world. She cares about her family. She's a great mixture of many traits.
A quick read.
You didn't like it?
It was a very exciting and imaginative story, Joe.
But?
Yes, but. But you are capable of so much more. When I asked you to describe your sister, what did you do? I'll tell you what you did. You talked in depth about her various good points and bad points. You said that she is a mixture of these traits. That is because she is a real person. Real people are complex. Here, take a look at your villain in the maroon heart.
The Crimson Skull, Jimmy?
Just so. Your villain, how is he described? Simply as a villain. Black-hearted Peter was a villain that preyed on the innocent by night. This is no character. But a caricature. But great, timeless characters are often riddled with character flaws. It's what makes them so great. But you've read what I read, yes? Little funny stories, nothing too big. But do you know what I wish I could write? Do you know Schubert's Ladder?
I've heard you singing it.
You did? Oh, you did? Well, I hope my rendition wasn't too bad.
You have a lovely voice.
Did you understand it?
No, it was in German.
Ideally, that should make no difference. Each song has a tune that transcends mere language. But listen to me, the literature professor going on. It is such an accomplishment just to get anything published. You make money, yes? You can pay the bills, you can eat.
We can both eat.
Very good, I stand corrected. I never knew volcanoes were so magnanimous.
So you're saying that I should write about the things I care about instead of the things I don't?
Well, you know them more than
paid late Peter the scourge of seven seas.
That is an idea.
Stick to it, Joe. You have a true talent. Do not waste it on such trifles. I believe that one day you could have a book so great that it could be on the same shelf as Shakespeare.
Stories?
What? Have you gotten some published?
Really?
Really? And I've made a little money. Enough to buy you that new piano like I always promised.
I don't play piano anymore. But I do think about it sometimes. How my fingers will touch the keys. Do you remember how to play piano for the Olympic Society?
How could I forget?
You write the words first, you go out the mouth. Adventurous, maybe not, but wonderful. Beth, your life is so full of wonder that no page could ever truly paint. Would you do such a story? I believe you are a story, but you're often inside your own.
Well, for one thing, I'd show it to a professor friend of mine. He might like it. Shall I tell you some of it? Once was a girl with a heart so large that the whole world could see it as she walked. She had three accomplished sisters, but in her own special way, she was the best of all. She was a hero. She was heroic. She fought in battles, but she was a champion. Another New Year's upon us. Beth has been gone since autumn. The whole house is quiet without her. The only noise we hear is when Meg and John come over with their friends and wreck the house. No one seems to mind one bit. Still, I long for those days in this very chair, with all five members of our Pickwick Society, pondering the mysteries of the world. Corey!
Just a few days ago. We stopped by to see Meg, John, and the twins. I wanted to rush here to see you, but my wife stayed back a bit.
Do what?
Oh, the dickens! Here I am, spending all this time trying to surprise you, and then I just come out and say it!
You've gone and got married. To who?
To Amy.
To Amy?
On the continent, it all gathered because of your letter about how passed. Joe, I am terribly sorry about that.
I love this place so damn much.
Such a kind, gentle girl.
These are terrible. No one here has really gotten over it.
Finally, after enough time to pass, I turned to your sister and said, let's just be married, man.
You always have everything exactly as you like.
Not everything.
And Aunt March agreed.
After some convincing, she found it a mighty fine idea.
But you two married. I can't believe it.
It's not quite a great big step, as you might think. Amy and I had seen a lot of each other on the continent. She and I grew close. Closer, I think, than you and I were this whole darn year. My wife is quite wonderful, Joe.
I don't think so.
You want to know the moment I knew? I mean, the moment I knew that she was the one for me? It seems silly, but it's something I know you'd understand.
Please.
On summer days, we'd go out boating. I'd go out with both my arms, and she'd sit there in a pink dress with that parasol face. She noticed I'd retired, and one day, she said to me, why don't we just go together? Such a simple thing, really. I'm a fool for not thinking of it myself. My wife is an awful rower. Please don't tell her I said that. She'll let my head for that. She would row in circles if I had let her roll by myself. But together, we stayed on the straight and narrow, and it was great fun. I really do love my wife.
Funny how you call Amy your wife. What does she call you?
My lord and master, of course.
Of course she does.
Now, really, Joe, you ought to have more respect for me. I am your brother-in-law, after all.
Are you really?
Really, truly, really. Joe. Now, Joe, there's one thing that needs to be said. And we can put this all to bed for now, till the end. I think I shall always love you. But with Amy, I see that things are different. This is how things were meant to be. But now I can spend the rest of my life with the two most important women in it. With you as my sister, and Amy as my wife.
Sister-in-law. So, Lori, are we going to be happy or not?
Oh my heavens!
Well, this is rather very difficult to explain.
Happy New Year!
1868 already!
Happy New Year! Amy, I'm so happy with the two of you. Isn't it wonderful? I've always wanted Lori part of the family.
What?
Well, shall we set the dinner table? Yes.
Splendid idea.
Yes, come in. Oh, Lord.
Sorry, I thought that Joe would answer the door.
You must be Joe's New York friend, Professor M.
There, isn't it obvious? And you must be Lori, that is Mr. Lawrence. She has spoken of you quite often.
I see. Shall I go get Joe? She's just off in the other room.
No, wait. I must ask. Aren't you married?
Me? Well, yes, I am.
Then I am truly embarrassed. I came here without seeing you. You see, I have a gift for Joe, but I would much rather not see her. If you are married to her, would you please give this gift for me?
You misunderstand, Professor. I'm married to Amy, her sister.
Her sister? Then Joe is not.
Joe is quite unattached, if that's what you're wondering.
Oh, then please do call her. Oh, wait, let me put my hat back on. You see, this is what I was wearing when I first met her, so I thought it would be funny.
Very funny, Mr. Baird. Joe! Oh, Joe, a great big wild animal has come to see you.
Lori, what are you talking about? Professor Bear.
Unmasked.
It's wonderful.
Here, Professor, let me take your head
Oh, Amy!
Oh, shit.
Joe, I did a favor for you. I hope you will not mind.
What's that?
I showed you your manuscript to my publisher.
It's my book about that.
Joe, he loved it. He said it touched his heart.
My words in a book with pages and a binding and ink.
Which I thought was quite funny since I never knew you had a heart. He said that if I would act as her agent, he would publish it immediately.
My best, by Josephine Markle.
So, I agreed, and he decided to print 1,000 copies. 1,000 copies, Joe. Can you believe that? We need to sell very well. I hope you do not mind.
Mind. This is the most amazing thing that ever happened.
Joe, your sister, your Beth, she did not die. She is alive. In your words, in your book. And 1,000 people, maybe more, who knows? They will read your book. And they will love them as you love them.
Thank you, Peter.
You know, I think this is the first time you've called me by my first name.
Really? I've thought.
Oh, I have thought too, Joe. I've thought of nothing but you since you left me.
Oh.
In fact, I wanted to say something to you back in New York, but then your sister Beth, she got sick, so. You had to run off, so I spoke not, but now I must be Joe. I wanted to know if I was more than a friend to you. Joe, you give me so much hope and courage, and I have nothing to offer you but a full heart. So much older than you, and I can offer so little.
You offer more than no, just ask.
Could you ever see yourself marrying a foolish, simple man with such a
Thank you.